we usually think that they are the most privileged ones, the children of Israel. They are the chosen ones. They are the most beloved. That's how we look at whom? The children of Israel. A question, does God have any favorites? Any favorites? If he has favorites, then he is not God. If he has favorites, am I not his son? Or are they his special sons? Does he love everyone the same way? Whether we love him or not, he loves all of us the same way, even if we don't believe. But now when we are looking at the children of Israel, we need to know why God is using them or choosing them. Why God, in one way, in our day-to-day language, the children of Israel are just dummies. You understand? Dummies means you go to the store, you look at a phone, there are dummies kept on the table. Why do they have the dummies? So that you can have a look at them.
Sample.
Same way, God is using the children of Israel as a sample and talking to us. So he is directly talking to me by using whom? Children of Israel. This is who you are, and this is who I am. So looking at this nation, God is, his dealings with them, he's revealing who is to us. And one simple thing, we think that they are the chosen ones, and at times when I first saw the Jews here in New York, I was excited. I said, yeah, they are the most privileged ones. They are the chosen ones. That's how I look at them. And how do they look at us? How do the Jews look at us? We look at them as how? The chosen. They look at us as though they look at dogs.
You think so?
That's what Jesus said. Is it true? So we are looking at them now and seeing how this nation is and how we are. So we can avoid a whole lot of problems which they had by looking at them. So we saw how Abraham is called, and then finally wandering in the wilderness. And look at the privilege they have. They have the temple. Man walked out of the garden. He said, I'll walk on my own. And now can you see God following man? He tells Moses, I want you to build a temple. Why? I want to dwell in your midst. That's his desire. So they, when they have the temple, can you see these people? And these, I'm just showing you pictures so that you understand. Where is God? In their midst. And what are they doing? Loving him? Do they love him? They are murmuring, grumbling, remembering their olden days when they had garlics, leeks, onions. Where? But they don't remember the whippings they got. But they are remembering what? the garlics, the pumpkin. And now they say we are fed up of manna. We are fed up of manna. And they are not working for 40 years, they are just getting it free and they say we are fed up. And they say we need meat. Right, you remember that, I am not going into it. And God said, yeah, you want meat, I'll give you. Not one day, not five, but till it comes out from your... That's how much I'll give you. That's why we have to be careful. You are nurturing some desires, God will fulfill it. God will fulfill your desires, and then you had it. He gave them meat, and then when it was still in their mouth, what happened? Kill them. Why? Not satisfied with what I give you? That's God talking to us. Can we be content where God has placed and leave it in the hands of God? He'll take care. And then he's dwelling in the midst, murmuring, grumbling, finally going to dust. They left Egypt, started their journey towards Canaan, crossed the Red Sea. Look at this thing. They saw the hand of God. They walked through the Red Sea. They saw the water stand as a wall. It's not their grandfather's story. They have seen it. They have seen the bitter water turn sweet. They have eaten the manna, but still perished where? In the wilderness. So just to give you an example, now, Old Testament is a shadow. So Egypt stands for whom? Egypt is a shadow for whom?
Oh, the word.
Pharaoh? Pharaoh stands for whom? If Egypt is world, Pharaoh is Satan. Red Sea? Red Sea is a shadow for what? So you leave the world, walk through Red Sea. What does that mean?
Baptism.
So now, after baptism, where do you step in? Wilderness. And what does Jordan stand for? Jordan.
Death to self.
Death. You left Egypt for Canaan, and then you die before reaching Canaan. Jordan stands for dying to your self. And Canaan shows victorious Christian life. So we need to experience victorious Christian life where? Here, before our departure. But many think that Jordan is just death. In Canaan you have wars. In heaven are we going to have wars? It's here. So now, can you see, the time has come for them to enter the promised land. And now let's turn to book of Leviticus. Now we'll read those three chapters. And I want you to open your Bibles. So that I'll read aloud and you just follow. Leviticus chapter 26. We'll read chapter Leviticus 26. I'll read. You just look at your Bible, look at the verses. Now it's time for the children of Israel to enter the promised land. And before Moses goes, these are three chapters that Moses is just telling the people of Israel, reading it to them. Ye shall make no idols, nor carved image, neither rear up you up a standing image, neither shall ye set up any image of stone in your land to bow down unto it, for I am the Lord your God. Ye shall keep my Sabbaths and reverence my sanctuary, I am the Lord. If ye walk in my statutes and keep my commandments and do them, then I will give you rain in due season, and the land shall yield her increase, and the trees of the field shall yield their fruit, and your threshing shall reach unto the vintage, and the vintage shall reach unto the sowing time, and ye shall eat your bread to the full and dwell in your land safely. And I'll give peace in the land, and ye shall lie down, and none shall make you afraid. I will rid evil beasts out of the land, neither shall the sword go through your land. And ye shall chase your enemies, and they shall fall before you by the sword. And five of you shall chase 100, and 100 of you shall put 10,000 to flight, and your enemies shall fall before you by the sword. For I will have respect unto you, and make you fruitful, and multiply you, and establish my covenant with you. And ye shall eat old store, and bring forth the old because of the new. And I will set my tabernacle among you, and my soul shall not abhor you. And I will walk among you, and will be your God, and ye shall be my people. I am the Lord your God, who brought you forth out of the land of Egypt, that ye shall not be their slave, and I have broken the bands of your yoke and made you go upright. Now these are the blessings. Now the next. But if ye will not hearken unto me, and will not do all these commandments, and if ye shall despise my statutes, or if your soul abhor my ordinances, so that ye will not do all my commandments, but that ye break my covenant, I also will do this unto you. I will even appoint over you terror, consumption, and the burning fever that shall consume the eyes and cause sorrow of heart, and ye shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it. And I will set my face against you, and ye shall be slain before your enemies. They that hate you shall reign over you, and ye shall flee when none pursueth you. And if ye will not yet for all this hearken unto me, then I'll punish you 7 times more for your sins. And I'll break the pride of your power. I'll make your heaven as brass, as iron, and your earth as bronze. And your strength shall be spent in vain, for your land shall not yield her increase, neither shall the trees of the land yield their fruits. And if you will walk contrary unto me, and will not hearken unto me, I will bring 7 times more plagues upon you according to your sins. I will also send wild beasts among you, which shall rob you of your children, and destroy your cattle, and make you few in number, and your highways shall be desolate. And if you will not be reformed by me by these things, but will walk contrary unto me, then will I also walk contrary unto you, and will punish you yet 7 times for your sins. And I'll bring a sword upon you that shall avenge the vengeance of my covenant. And when ye are gathered together within your cities, I will send the pestilence among you, and ye shall be delivered into the hand of the enemy. And when I have broken the staff of your bread, 10 women shall bake your bread in 1 oven, and they shall deliver you your bread again by weight, and ye shall eat and not be satisfied. And if ye will not for all this hearken unto me, but walk contrary unto me, then I will walk contrary unto you also in fury. And I will chastise you 7 times for your sins. And ye shall eat the flesh of your sons, and the flesh of your daughters shall ye eat. And I'll destroy your high places, and cut down your images, and cast your carcasses upon the carcasses of your idols. And my soul shall abhor you. And I'll make your cities waste, and bring your sanctuaries unto desolation. And I will not smell the savor of your sweet odors. And I will bring the land into desolation, and your enemies who dwell therein shall be astonished at it. And I will scatter you among the nations, and will draw out a sword after you, and your land shall be desolate, and your cities waste. Then shall the land enjoy her Sabbaths, as long as it lies desolate. And ye are in your enemy's land, even then shall the land rest, and enjoy her Sabbaths. As long as it lieth desolate, it shall rest, because it did not rest in your Sabbaths, when ye dwelt upon it. And upon them who left alive of you, I will send a faintness into their hearts in the lands of their enemies, and the sound of a shaken leaf shall chase them, and they shall flee as fleeing from a sword, and they shall fall when none pursueth. And they shall fall one upon another as it were before a sword, when none pursueth. And ye shall have no power to stand before your enemies, and ye shall perish among the nations, and the land of your enemies shall eat you up. And they who are left of you shall pine away in their iniquity in your enemies' land, and also in the iniquities of their fathers shall they pine away with them. And if they shall confess their iniquities and the iniquities of their fathers with their trespass which they trespassed against me, and that also they have walked contrary unto me, and that I have walked contrary unto them, and have brought them into the land of their enemies, if then their uncircumcised hearts be humbled, and they then accept of the punishment of their iniquity, then will I remember my covenant with Jacob, and also my covenant with Isaac, and also my covenant with Abraham will I remember, and I will remember the land. The land also shall be left by them, and shall enjoy her Sabbaths, while she lieth desolate without them, and they shall accept of the punishment of their iniquity, because they despised mine ordinances, because of their soul abhorred my statutes. And yet for all that, when they are in the land of their enemies, I will not cast them away, neither will I abhor them to destroy them utterly, and to break my covenant with them. For I am the Lord their God, but I will for their sakes remember the covenant of their ancestors, whom I brought forth out of the land of Egypt in the sight of the nations, that I might be their God. I am the Lord. These are the statutes and ordinances and laws which the Lord made between him and the children of Israel in Mount Sinai by the hand of Moses. Why I read this? We could save a lot of time by asking you to go home and just read. Why I'm just reading is, we have heard a lot of sermons, preachings, and it is time we just read what? As it is written. Here, can you understand how specific, clearly, God says he will do? And God doesn't give empty threats. No. If he said it, he will do it. That's the difference between us and God. We threaten. But God, if he said it, that's why he said, heaven and earth shall. This we are reading in 2017. You look back, word for word has happened. And that's called history. Word for word. These Jewish women and men cooked their own kids. Some of them ate them raw. Who made them eat? It was God. Made the women and the men eat their kids raw. We have not seen that side of God. We think it's the devil doing it. I told you. If you obey, I will take care of everything. But if you turn away, you understand what he said. So that's why this book, this is not some man's writing, this is whose word? Can I just trust this book? I turn to the left or right, I'm asking for trouble. And then, if God raises his hand against us, Can any bondage breakers, can any deliverance ministry people save us?
No.
You are done. Because who is doing it? And then if you just obey, do you have to worry about anything? Now look at the children of Israel, they are in the wilderness. Balaam came to curse. What did he end up with?
Bless.
He blessed. Same way, now let's turn to Deuteronomy 11. I'll read it again. Therefore, I'm reading Deuteronomy 11. Therefore, thou shalt love the Lord thy God and keep his charge and his statutes and his ordinances and his commandment always. And know ye this day, for I speak not with your children who have not known, who have not seen the chastisement of the Lord your God, his greatness, his mighty hand, and his outstretched arm. When Moses is saying this, he's talking to people who have seen. They are witness to the hand of God, to how he did everything for them. During the wilderness journey, you know, the sun stood still. The fact is, it was the earth that applied the brakes. Why? The battle was on. Till Israel defeated the enemies, the earth is not revolving. It's standing there. Can you imagine the privilege we have? The Creator is with me. Is it true? I am the temple of whom? That's all. Then I don't have to worry about anything. The sun stood still means the earth, it's not moving. Why? The battle is on. And that's how God stood with whom? Israel. From the rock he gave them what? Drinking water. And how many years they drank? 40. Turned the bitter water. Look at our life. Has he done things in our lives? Have we seen miracles? Have we? Are we witness of the hand of the Lord in our lives? All of you? Yes or no?
Yes.
Why did he do those miracles in our lives? He showed. He showed that he is with us. Not only with Abraham, but with? Have you seen miracles? He has not heard all our prayers. He has not answered all our prayers. But has he done things that you never prayed for? What does that mean? Next, we see. And I'm reading from verse 3. And his miracles and his acts, which he did in the midst of Egypt unto Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, and unto all his land. What he did unto the army of Egypt, unto their horses and to their chariots, how he made the water of the Red Sea to overflow them as they pursued after you, and how the Lord had destroyed them unto this day. What he did unto you in the wilderness until ye came into this place, and what he did unto Dathan and Abiram, the sons of Eliab, the son of Reuben. How the earth opened its mouth and swallowed them up, and their households and their tents and all the substance that was in their possession in the midst of all Israel. But your eyes have seen all the great acts of the Lord which he did. Therefore shall ye keep all the commandments which I command you this day, that ye may be strong and go in and possess the land to which ye go to possess it. And that ye may prolong your days in the land, which the Lord swore unto your fathers to give unto them and to their seed, a land that floweth with milk and honey. For the land to which thou goest in to possess it is not as the land of Egypt from where ye came out, where thou sowest thy seed and waterest it with thy foot as a garden of herbs. But the land to which ye go to possess it, it's a land of hills and valleys, and drinketh water of the rain of heaven, a land which the Lord thy God careth for. The eyes of the Lord thy God are always upon it, from the beginning of the year even unto the end of the year. And it shall come to pass, if ye shall hearken diligently unto my commandments which I command you this day, to love the Lord your God, and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul, that I will give you the rain of your land in its due season, the first rain and the latter rain, that thou mayest gather in thy grain and thy wine and thine oil. And I will send grass in thy fields for thy cattle, that thou mayest eat and be full. Take heed to yourselves, that your heart be not deceived, and ye turn aside and serve other gods and worship them. And then the Lord's wrath be kindled against you, and he shut up the heaven, and there be no rain, and that the land yield not her fruit, and lest ye perish quickly from off the good land which the Lord giveth you. Therefore shall ye lay up these my words in your heart and in your soul, and bind them for a sign upon your hand, that they may be as a frontlet between your eyes. And ye shall teach them to your children, speaking of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt write them upon the doorposts of thine house and upon thy gates, that your days may be multiplied, and the days of your children in the land which the Lord swore unto your fathers to give them, as the days of heaven upon the earth. For if ye shall diligently keep all these commandments, which I command you to do them, to love the Lord your God, to walk in all his ways, and to cleave unto him, then will the Lord drive out all these nations from before you, and ye shall possess greater nations, and mightier than the yourselves. Every place whereon the soles of your feet shall tread shall be yours, and the wilderness and Lebanon, from the river Euphrates, even unto the uttermost sea shall your border be. There shall no man be able to stand before you, for the Lord your God shall lay the fear of you and the dread of you upon all the land that ye shall tread upon, as he hath said unto you. Behold, I set before you this day a blessing and a curse. Can we just stop? What is God saying? I am laying before you what? Blessing and curse. Many times we think it's the devil who curses. It's not. Devil has got nothing to do with the curse. Who is the one who curses? The scripture says, I am laying before you what? Blessing and curse. You decide which one you want. And then, a blessing if you obey the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you this day, and a curse if you will not obey the commandments of the Lord your God, but turn aside out of the way which I command you this day, to go after other gods, which ye have not known. And it shall come to pass, when the Lord thy God hath brought thee in unto the land to which thou goest to possess it, that thou shalt put the blessing upon Mount Gerizim, and the curse upon Mount Ebal. Are they not on the other side of Jordan? By the way where the sun goeth down, in the land of Canaanites, who dwell in the Arabah, over against Gilgal, beside the plains of Moreh. For ye shall pass over the Jordan, to go in to possess the land which the Lord your God giveth you, and ye shall possess it, and dwell therein, and ye shall observe to do all the statutes and ordinances which I set before you this day. So here we just stop. Why is God saying all of this? He has given man the free will. Now why are you telling them blessing and curse? Can you just leave us alone? The simple reason, he has set out with a purpose, and he will do it, whether we like it or not. He is bringing the children of Israel from captivity taking them into the promised land. But before they step in, they are being... Is it clearly mentioned? Are they clearly told? What are they supposed to do? What are they supposed to do? Just obey. In our language, New Testament language, just trust. If you go after other gods, you had it. And you know the children of Israel, did they go after others? Yeah. And just, and this chapter, Elijah, when he's praying, he goes down on his knees and he says, you said it, what? I will stop the rain. And I want you to do it. And did it not, and it did not rain for how many years? Prayer is taking God at his word. Now, let's move on. Deuteronomy 28. I hope you are not tired. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth. And all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee, if thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God. Blessed shalt thou be in the city, and blessed shalt thou be in the field. Blessed shall be the fruit of thy body, and the fruit of thy ground, and the fruit of thy cattle, and increase of thy cows, and the flocks of thy sheep. Blessed shall be thy basket and thy kneading trough. Blessed shalt thou be when thou comest in, and blessed shalt thou be when thou goest out. The Lord shall cause thine enemies who rise up against thee to be smitten before thy face, and they shall come out against thee one way, and flee before thee seven ways. The Lord shall command the blessing upon thee in thy storehouses, and in all that thou settest thine hand unto. And he shall bless thee in the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. The Lord shall establish thee an holy people unto himself, as he hath sworn unto thee, if thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God, and walk in his ways. And all the people of the earth shall see that thou art called by the name of the Lord, and they shall be afraid of thee. And the Lord shall make thee plenteous in goods, in the fruit of thy body, and in the fruit of thy cattle, and in the fruit of thy ground, in the land which the Lord swore unto thy fathers to give thee. The Lord shall open unto thee his good treasure, the heaven, to give the rain unto the land in its season, and to bless all the work of thy hand. And thou shalt lend unto many nations, and thou shalt not borrow. And the Lord shall make thee the head, and not the tail, and thou shalt be above only, and thou shalt not be beneath, if thou hearken unto the commandments of the Lord thy God, which I command thee this day, to observe and to do them. And thou shalt not go aside from any of the words which I command thee this day, to the right hand or to the left, to go after other gods to serve them. But it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. Cursed shalt thou be in the city, and cursed shalt thou be in the field. Cursed shall be thy basket and thy kneading trough. Cursed shall be the fruit of thy body and the fruit of thy land, the increase of thy cows and the flocks of thy sheep. Cursed shall thou be when thou comest in, and cursed shall thou be when thou goest out. The Lord shall send upon thee cursing, vexation, and rebuke in all that thou settest thine hand to do, until thou be destroyed, and until thou perish quickly because of the wickedness of thy doings, whereby thou hast forsaken me. The Lord shall make the pestilence cling unto thee, until he have consumed thee from off the land to which thou goest to possess it. The Lord shall smite thee with a consumption, and with a fever, and with an inflammation, and with an extreme burning, and with the sword, and with blight, and with mildew. And they shall pursue thee until thou perish. And thy heaven that is over thy head shall be bronze, and the earth that is under thee shall be iron. The Lord shall make the rain of thy land powder and dust, From heaven shall it come down upon thee until thou be destroyed. The Lord shall cause thee to be smitten before thine enemies. Thou shalt go out one way against them and flee seven ways before them, and shall be removed into all the kingdoms of the earth. And the carcass shall be food unto all fowls of the air and unto the beasts of the earth, and no man shall drive them away. The Lord shall smite thee with the boil of Egypt, and with the tumors, and with the scab, and with the itch, whereof thou canst not be healed. The Lord shall smite thee with madness and blindness and astonishment of heart, and thou shalt grope at noonday, as the blind gropeth in darkness, and thou shalt not prosper in thy ways, and thou shalt be only oppressed and spoiled evermore, and no man shall save thee. Thou shalt betroth a wife, and another man shall lie with her. Thou shalt build a house, and thou shalt not dwell therein. Thou shalt plant a vineyard, and shalt not gather the grapes thereof. Thine ox shall be slain before thine eyes, and thou shalt not eat thereof. Thine ass shall be violently taken away from before thy face, and shall not be restored to thee. Thy sheep shall be given unto thine enemies, and thou shalt have none to rescue them. The sons of the and thy daughters shall be given unto another people, and thine eyes shall look and fail with longing for them all the day long, and they shall be no might in thine hand. The fruit of thy land and all thy labors shall a nation whom thou knowest not eat up, and thou shalt be only oppressed and crushed always, so that thou shalt be mad for the sight of thine eyes, which thou shalt see. The Lord shall smite thee in the knees and in the legs, and with a sore boil thou cannot be healed, from the sole of thy foot unto the top of thy head. The Lord shall bring thee and thy king, whom thou shalt set over thee, unto a nation whom neither thou nor thy fathers have known, and there shalt thou serve other gods, wood and stone. And thou shalt become an astonishment, a proverb, and a byword among all nations, to which the Lord shall lead thee. Thou shalt carry much seed out into the field, and shall gather but little in, for the locusts shall consume it. Thou shalt plant vineyards, and dress them, but shall neither drink of the wine nor gather the grapes, for the worms shall eat them. Thou shalt have olive trees throughout all thy borders, but thou shalt not anoint thyself with the oil, for thine olive shall cast its fruit. Thou shalt beget sons and daughters, but thou shalt not enjoy them, for they shall go into captivity, and all thy trees and fruit of thy land shall the locust consume. The sojourner who is within thee shall get up above thee very high, and thou shalt come down very low. He shall lend to thee, and thou shalt not lend to him. He shall be the head, and thou shalt be the tail. Moreover, all the curses shall come upon thee, and shall pursue thee, and overtake thee till thou be destroyed, because thou hearkenest not unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to keep his commandments and his statutes, which he commanded thee. And they shall be upon thee for a sign, and for a wonder, and upon thy seed forever, because thou servest not the Lord thy God with joyfulness and with gladness of heart, for the abundance of all things. Therefore shall thou serve thine enemies, whom the Lord shall send against thee, in hunger, and in thirst, and in nakedness, and in lack of all things, and he shall put a yoke of iron upon thy neck until he have destroyed thee. The Lord shall bring a nation against thee from far, from the end of the earth, as swift as the eagle flyeth, a nation whose tongue thou shalt not understand, the nation of fierce countenance, who shall not regard the person of the old, nor show favor to the young. And he shall eat the fruit of thy cattle, and the fruit of thy land, until thou be destroyed, who also shall not leave thee either grain, wine, or oil, or the increase of thy cows or flocks of thy sheep, until he have destroyed thee. And he shall besiege thee in all thy gates, until thy high and fortified walls come down, wherein thou trustest, throughout all thy land. And he shall besiege thee in all thy gates throughout all thy land, which the Lord thy God hath given thee. And thou shalt eat the fruit of thine own body, the flesh of thy sons and of thy daughters, whom the Lord thy God hath given thee, in the siege and in the distress wherewith thy enemies shall distress thee. So that the man who is tender among you, and very delicate, his eyes shall be evil toward his brother, and toward the wife of his bosom, and toward the remnant of his children whom he shall leave, so that he will not give to any of them of the flesh of his children, whom he shall eat, because he hath nothing left in the siege, and in the distress wherewith thy enemies shall distress thee in all thy gates. Mm-hmm. The tender and delicate woman among you who shall not venture to set the sole of her foot upon the ground for delicateness and tenderness, her eyes shall be evil toward the husband of her bosom, and toward her son, and toward her daughter, and toward her young one who cometh out from between her feet, and toward her children whom she shall bear, for she shall eat them for the lack of all things, secretly in the siege and distress wherewith thine enemy shall distress thee in thy gates. If thou wilt not observe to do all the words of this law that are written in this book, that thou mayest fear this glorious and fearful name, the Lord thy God, then the Lord will make thy plagues wonderful, and the plagues of thy seed even great plagues, and a long continuance, and severe sickness, and a long continuance. Moreover, he'll bring upon thee all the diseases of Egypt, which thou wast afraid of, and they shall cling unto thee. Also every sickness and every plague which is not written in the book of this law, them will the Lord bring upon thee, until thou be destroyed. And ye shall be left few in number, whereas ye were as the stars of heaven for multitude, because thou wouldst not obey the voice of the Lord thy God. And it shall come to pass that as the Lord rejoiced over you to do you good and to multiply you, so the Lord will rejoice over you to destroy you and to bring you to nothing. And ye shall be plucked from off the land to which thou goest to possess it. And the Lord shall scatter thee among all people, from the one end of the earth even unto the other. And there thou shalt serve other gods, which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone. And among these nations shall thou find no ease, neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest. But the Lord shall give thee there a trembling heart, and failing of eyes, and sorrow of mind. Thy life shall hang in doubt before thee, and thou shalt fear day and night, and shall have no assurance of thy life. In the morning thou shalt say, Would God it were evening. And at evening thou shalt say, Would God it were morning. For the fear of thine heart, wherewith thou shalt fear, and for the sight of thine eyes, which thou shalt see, the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships, by the way whereof I spoke unto thee, thou shalt see it no more again. And there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for male and female slaves, and no man shall buy you. I just read this. Will God do the same with us? A question. Will God?
Verse?
Just tell me. We just read the scriptures. Moses told this clearly, black and white. And God already sees that they are going to appoint a king. And he said it. Will God do the same with us? Yes? No? Why I am saying, today many people are after the blessings. God bless Israel, so God will bless me. So the curse that came upon them, if you get those blessings, then what also? It's a combo pack. You can't just say, I need blessings, but I won't get the curse. But I am asking a question. Will God do the same with us? New Testament. Yes? No?
Yes, you will.
Yes? No? Decide.
We have seen much more than they saw.
Have you seen much more?
Throughout all this history.
This is Old Testament. I am talking about the New Testament.
Yes, we have also seen the New.
Jesus said to his disciples, Know ye not what spirit ye are of? The Son of Man came not to destroy.
Fine.
But to save the world.
Fine. So now, are we saved?
You have to
understand the difference between God talking to Israel, talking to us. You have to I just want you to understand, why is he so hard with the children of Israel? Is he not literally dragging them? Dragging them? Threatening them? Why? After he paid the price on the cross, you know the language changes. What's the language? If you want to follow me, he will not threaten us, because we have seen his work on the cross. Now, it's up to you. Want to walk? You walk. But he'll not threaten you with curses and make you walk. That's the New Testament church. He is not going to force us to walk. Only those who have understood his love don't walk for blessings. Don't walk because the fear of judgment will come. No. Now it's a love relationship. You understand the standard? Why he led them like this? Because the price has to be paid. He has his purpose. Now he showed his love on the cross. Now it's up to me. Don't walk because you want to be blessed. Don't walk because you want a good produce from the field. That's what he did with whom? Children of Israel. But for us, what's the principle? If we want to follow. So it's up to us. He'll not punish me now. He won't trouble me. He won't. You decide I don't want God's will. He won't threaten you. But you need to understand, he'll just leave you alone. And that's worse than this. And if he forsakes you to your desires, it's worse than this. In this at least, what is God doing? He says, I will thrash you, punish you. So now, let's move on. Moses is gone. And now the time has come for the children of Israel to cross Jordan. And then, now who is the leader? The next guy comes. Joshua moves into the picture. Who is gone? Moses. He is one man from his birth till his death, things are mentioned. He just says, he just leads, and he moves on. And then now, Joshua, under his leadership, can you see, Red Sea opened the way. And now when God is leading these people, who opens the highway? Jordan. Jordan can't stop them. And they are crossing when it is flooded. And then you remember, before they cross, you know one crazy thing. 2.5 tribes. Reuben, Gad, half of Manasseh. What have they decided? We don't want to go there. Can you imagine? Started journey from Egypt. They say, we are content where? And Joshua said, fine, no problem. You want to stay here? You stay here. But do one thing. Cross Jordan, come to Canaan, fight the battles, see for yourself, and then come back. And they went, did everything, came back, and you know history? Who were the first ones to go into slavery? These 2.5. When the Assyrians come, These are the first ones who are taken into slavery. That's a lesson for us. Many people decide, I don't want that closeness with God. I'm happy. Where? Wilderness. Eating manna. But then remember, when they crossed into Jordan, across Jordan, they had their first harvest. What stopped?
Yeah,
no more manna. That was for the wilderness journey. Now no more welfare. Welfare stops. Now you have to work hard, toil, and get your own produce. But then let's just see how they are moving. They cross Jordan. And as they cross Jordan, the fear of the people of Israel falls upon whom?
Jericho.
The possessors have come. Exactly. 400 years. As God had said, how many went from here?
70.
The first one to go was whom? Joseph. Now, when they are crossing Jordan, Joseph is also there. His body is also coming, right? And more than 3 million are crossing. Can you see here? A country coming out of a country, coming back to their land to possess it. And what? The fear of God fell on whom? And then another interesting thing. Before they start their campaigns, they need to circumcise. And the men, you must have read that. I'm not going into it. They're circumcised. And are they weak? But during that time, no one dared touch them. They are weak. Because what are they doing? Getting circumcised means, yes, we know. Circumcision is a sign of the covenant God has made with Abraham. You know one incident, God wanted to kill Moses at the inn. Have you read it?
Mm-hmm.
Why? He is going to deliver Israel out of Egypt, but his children are not. You forget about the deliverance ministry. You're not circumcised. What does that mean? You question my faithfulness. He was about to kill Moses. If I had made a covenant, don't doubt my faithfulness, I will do it. So now they are circumcised, and then, you know, Jericho, they start their campaigns. The wall comes down. Then they are defeated. And then can you see the campaigns? Later on you can look at these maps and how God moved with his people. And he said, where all you keep your step, those I will. But they were commanded to remove all these people. But what did the tribes of Israel do? They made them servants. What were you told? And Israel, you have an incident, Gibeonites, they made an alliance, and now you can't drive them out. And what happened? These very people with whom they made alliance, they became headaches for Israel. So, from that, what do we understand? Can I just obey? Can I just do what I am told to do? And rest all whom will God will take care. But then, slowly, slowly, what happens? Joshua, now the time of Joshua to go has come. And Joshua said unto the people, Joshua 24:19, ye cannot serve the Lord, for he is a holy God, he is a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgression nor your sins. He warned them. Be careful. Now therefore fear the Lord and serve Him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom ye will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that are on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. He said that. He finished his work and he is gone. And now, look at the children of Israel. Now comes whom? The judges. We started with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Moses, Joshua, and now who moves in? Why the judges? Can you see the land of Israel divided? Each tribe being given their lands. But they made those alliances. And then what happened? How many judges? Can you count?
Othniel, Ehud, Shamgar, Deborah, Gideon, Tola, Jair, Jephthah, Ibzan, Elon, Abdon, Samson. How many?
12. The reason why judges are coming, because, can you see this picture?
That's the story. There is peace in the land. Israel serves the Lord. And after that, when there is no problem, what do they do? Back to square one. What does God do? Brings whom? Brings the Midianites, the Philistines, the Canaanites, and they trouble them. And when they are troubled, what happens? They become sincere. They start crying. And then God raises up a judge. And then Israel is delivered. Peace. And then the next circle. How many did God raise?
12. Is it not our story also? Look at these people. Were they warned? Were they warned? They were warned. And now, can you see how God is? You see them. God raised up whom? I'm just showing this picture so that you just get a picture, that's all. A lady. Where are the men? A lady comes up, named Deborah. Then, you know this guy? You should study. I'm not going into all their lives. It's you who has to spend some time. Study their lives. Jephthah, you know this guy? He made that vow. The first one who comes out of the house. And you know this guy? Samson. Look at this chart.
Othniel, he belongs to the tribe of Judah. Defeated Mesopotamia. Oppression was there for 8 years. And rest for 40 years. Next, Ehud belongs to tribe Benjamin. Moabites, 18 years oppression, 80 years peace. Then Shamgar, Philistines, it's not clear how many years there was peace. Deborah belongs to Ephraim, Canaanites, 20 years, rest for 40 years. Gideon from the tribe of Manasseh, Midianites were the enemies. 6 years there was oppression, 40 years there was peace. Then Tola, Issachar, 23 years. Jair, Manasseh, 22. Jephthah, Manasseh, Ammonites, 6 years there is peace. Ibzan is from Judah. Elon, Zebulun, 10 years. Abdon, Ephraim, 8 years. Samson, for 20 years. You need, as a serious Bible student, or as a believer, you need to know all of this. All of this. Can you see how God
raise up. You know about Samson. I'm not going into all of that. And he was a terror among whom? But then why God? And then you know the end of Samson. So now after time of Samson, you know who comes? Who was the next one after Samson? The most deadly. Samuel. He walks in. He understand, he, you know Samuel, a small boy in the temple. Elijah, the high priest there. Eli, the high priest. And that's when Samuel is there. And during those days, the children of Israel, during the days of Eli, what did they do? They took the ark for the battle. And what happened? The ark that was in the most holy place, can you look at the condition? Most holy place ark is captured by the Philistines. Can you stop and think, what is God up to? He allows his ark to be carried away. And then the ark is kept in the temple, that God falls down. And then again the next day, finally they are afraid. They put this thing on the bullock cart. And slowly, slowly the ark comes to Beth Shemesh. What happens? 50,070 dead. You remember that? Who are they? What's their nationality?
Israel.
How many Philistines died?
None.
And how many are dead here? 50,070 dead because they tried to gaze into the... You dare look inside me? That's God. They chose to disobey. And then, now, after that, and the ark didn't go back. Now the temple is in Shiloh, but the ark is somewhere else. And you know, when was the ark united with the temple?
David.
David brought it. But the temple, he wanted to build a temple. God says, it's only in the days of Solomon that the ark comes back into the temple.
But he had a tent.
He had a tent, but the tabernacle is where? The tent is just for whom? The ark. Rest candlestick, the altar of incense, the altar, where are they? They are in Shiloh. So, just stop and realize, understand how God is working out His purpose. And then now the children of Israel, they say, we want a king. And you know, God said, you want a king? It hurt Samuel. And God gave them a king. And you know his story? Someone who went in search of his father's donkey came back home as what? He went in search of whom? Father's lost donkeys. But then, let's turn to Isaiah chapter 5. Verse 1 onwards. Now, before you read this, I just want you to look here. The nation of Israel is represented by three trees, different trees. The first one is vine. It shows the spiritual privilege of this nation. Spiritual. Number two is the fig tree. It shows the national privilege of that nation. Number three, it's the olive tree. It stands for the religious privileges. So three trees show, are a shadow for this nation. So now first we are looking at the vine. Turn to Isaiah 5, verse 1 onwards, I'll read. Here it says, "Now will I sing to my beloved, a song of my beloved touching his vineyard. My beloved hath a vineyard in a very fruitful hill. And he dug it, and gathered out the stones, and planted it with the choicest wine, and built a tower in the midst of it, and also made a winepress in it. And he looked for it to bring forth grapes, and it brought forth wild grapes. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem, and men of Judah, judge, I pray you, between me and my vineyard. What could have been done more to my vineyard that I have not done in it? Why then have I looked for it to bring forth grapes, brought it forth wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will take away its hedge, and it shall be eaten up, and break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. And I will lay it waste, and it shall be pruned, nor digged, but there shall come up briars and thorns, and I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it." Along with this, can we turn to Psalms 80? Verse 8 onwards. Thou hast, Psalms 80, verse 8 onwards. Thou hast brought a vine out of Egypt. Thou hast cast out the nations and planted it. Thou preparest room before it, and didst cause it to take deep root, and it filled the land. The hills were covered with the shadow of it, and thy boughs thereof were like the goodly cedars. She sent out her boughs unto the sea, and her branches unto the river. Why hast thou then broken down her edges, so that all they who pass by the way do pluck her? So here we read, God says, the psalmist says, thou hast brought a vine out of Egypt. Now look at the ways of the Lord. Look at this chart. You can look at the history of Israel. Under the symbolism of vine, 430 years. And the birth of this nation itself is a miracle. Yeah. Isaac was given at the age of 100. God had said how many years? 430 from the time promise. Can you see this nation? First, it was in Palestine. Palestine means Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. They were where? Palestine. And then they went into Egypt 215 years. Did they go as slaves?
No.
Did they have a good time?
Yes.
They went as guests. But when they didn't want to come, that's when what happened? They started making bricks. And then 40 years, God says, I brought my vine. Thou hast brought a vine out of Egypt, and thou hast cast out the nations and planted it. He brings them out of Egypt, plants them where? Back in the land of Palestine. But then what did he expect? What all did he do? Read Isaiah 5. Look at what all he says. What all has he done? Isaiah 5. And he dug it. First is, had a vineyard in a very fruitful place. Brought you back. This is what I have done to you. It's the best place. Next, and he dug it, gathered the stones, planted it with the choicest vine, and built a tower. What's the tower for Israel? The temple is there. As long as God is there in their midst, no man dared touch it. But then what happened? Instead of bearing good fruits, what are they giving? Sour means they chose to walk on their own. They said, we want a king. And did they get kings? God gave them kings. Later on, you can look at that. First one was Saul, David, Solomon. And after Solomon, what happened? The 12 nations, 12 tribes have been divided into two nations. And these kings, some of them were good. David was one of them. But after some time, you know about Ahab and all, they rebelled against God, provoked God. Just look at this thing. When they are, God is sending his prophets. Look at the dealings of God with his people. Did he give the law? Have they been warned? But still, when they choose to rebel, God is sending whom? Sending his prophets. Why were the prophets coming? They are reminding something serious. Come back, turn back, otherwise you are asking for trouble. So can you see the long suffering of God? Patiently reminding. Now you just look at Ahab's time. Elijah, prophet, comes and what does he do? He prays for the rain to stop. Why? Why is he praying, Lord, I want you to stop the rain? Because he knows it's better for the rain to stop rather than going into slavery. Because you read what he said, Elijah knows, if we don't repent, man, it's who is going to spank? God is going to spank real hard. That's why he says it's better you stop the rain. But what did they do to the prophets? And you know the incident, Elijah is standing on Carmel. And he says, decide. What? You want Yehovah or Baal? And he puts the challenge before them and he says, the one who brings down the fire, let him be. And what did the people say? What did the people say?
Nothing.
Nothing? What did they say? Yeah. Let the one who brings down the... Can you look at a believer who has experienced the miracles of God? What are they saying now on Carmel? If Baal brings down fire, we are ready to accept. Can you understand the situation? What's Baal? I am ready to accept anyone who will fulfill my desires. Baal stands for someone who will fulfill your... And Israel is going after them. That's the same state of the people of the children of God today. By so many prosperity preachers, now that's the crazy stuff that's going on. God will bless, bless, bless. Sow your seed and you will be blessed. Anyone comes and they know marketing, the best marketing thing is what? Tell the people that God is going to bless and God is going to give you a job. So many things. And people, what do they want? What do they want? They want some blessings. And when Elijah is there, they say, yeah, if Baal brings down fire, And what happened? Could Baal bring down fire? Elijah. Prayer is a simple prayer, and you know, the anger of God, that fire falling from heaven, is not a small candlelight, it's a thunderbolt. The moment he says, boom, the altar is gone. That's the anger of God falling on the altar. And if Elijah had not erected that altar, can you imagine where this would have fallen? You have come to a point that you are ready to accept Baal while I am your God, thy Lord. Did he say that? And you want to accept that? Thank God for that Elijah. And then did they repent? Was the ministry of Elijah a success or a failure?
Was not a success.
Was it a success or a failure? Can you see one man interceded for that nation? And when he departs, can you read? What did Elisha say? And Elijah departed. 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 12. Second Kings chapter 2, verse 12. And Elisha saw it. And he cried. Now look at the cry of Elisha. My father, the chariot of Israel and its horsemen. And he saw him no more, and he took hold of his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. What is Elisha saying? Says the chariot of Israel and its horsemen. What does that mean? What does that mean? He's looking up. Elijah is gone. And he cries out, my father. And then he says, the chariot of Israel and the... Why? He's looking at Israel and he's saying, man, now he is gone. Now who will defend you? The chariot of Israel means the army. The strength of a nation is its army. What is Elisha saying? Man, he was the one who stood between you and God. Now he is gone, you are doomed. And it was a fact. Elisha went ahead and anointed whom? Hazael. The tormentor of whom? Israel. So why we are looking at this? Now we are going to just pray. Can you see God working out his purpose? What he has said to do, he will do. These are not stories. Can you see God doing his work? Baal? You want Baal? I know no one. There is no other God other than me. And you know, Elijah, after bringing down the fire, what did he do? Did he slaughter those priests, the prophets? He slaughtered them. Then he says, the rain is coming. They saw the rain and they understood that it is God who has stopped the rain. Did they know that? And you know one incident, when Elijah comes, Ahab is mad. And what did Ahab say when he met Elijah? Can you read that? Chapter 18, verse 17. And it came to pass when Ahab saw Elijah that Ahab said unto him, art thou he who troubleth Israel? And what did Elijah say? I have not troubled Israel, but thou and thy, you, not me. Look at the boldness of this man. It's God who raised him up. So it's God moving through whom? His prophets. And what is Israel doing to the prophets? Kill them. And then finally what happened? As had been said, the one who brought them to Egypt, to Canaan, he brings in whom? The Assyrians and the Babylonians. Why? And the same people, the chosen ones, what happens? Gone into slavery. And you know, when they are in slavery, you know what song they are singing? By the rivers of Babylon. Now you sing. You could have avoided this all mess. Now you remember what?
Zion.
Singing where? Just stop one thing. He destroyed his own temple. Who? The one who dwelt in that temple. You don't want me? I don't want you. Move on. Where are you going? We read in Deuteronomy, I love to hate you. That's the anger of God. So, usually we think that it's the devil. Is he anywhere around? Who is Israel dealing with? The devil or their Lord? And now they are in captivity. We are going to close. We are going to pray. God be willing, tomorrow we look at the captivity. Come tomorrow morning when you come, just read Daniel's prayer. One man, with his windows open, he is repenting for the nation. There was one man called Daniel. Let's close our eyes and bow our head. We just moved on from Exodus. And we have come to the book of about Daniel. Or in other words, we have done with Judges, Ruth, 1 Kings, 2 Kings, 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, 1 Chronicles, 2 Chronicles. The chosen ones who came from Egypt, the 10 tribes are lost forever. And the two, Judah and Benjamin, they too go into slavery. The reason they chose to ignore the commands. What we are reading is history. If he did this to his chosen ones, the warning is there in the New Testament, if thou shalt not bear fruit, thou shalt be cut. It's a warning for us. We have seen the hands of the Lord. We have seen the miracles He has done in our life. Each one of us who is sitting here, we have been witness to how God has manifested Himself to us and for us. He has been faithful and He has never changed. Never changed. When we look at His word, that awe, that reverence, what a mighty God we serve. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Look at His faithfulness. Hallelujah. Can we just talk to Him? We have read the Bible so many times. So many times. But tonight, Let's just look at our life. Hallelujah. Can we just open our mouth and let's not be ashamed. Let's not be ashamed. We are in the presence of our Father. Hallelujah. Can I trust Him? Can I trust Him? Hallelujah. Can I trust Him with my life? Jordan opened the way. The sun stood still. When you go home, you can read how the Lord fought for Israel when they came back to Canaan. The lightning, the brimstone. He said, wherever you put your feet, you'll take it. The walls of Jericho fell down because the possessors had come. We have a mighty God. Don't question His strength. Don't question His faithfulness. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Can we sing this song as we are in the presence of the Lord? O Lord my God, He is there in our midst this evening time. It's He who has arranged everything. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works Thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, Thy power throughout the universe displayed. Can we sing together? Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. When through the world and forest glades I wander, I hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. When I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing he bled and died. Away my sin, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration. Thank you, Lord. My God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. As our heads are bowed, just one simple reminder. The Spirit of the Lord tells me, that's why I'm telling you. Each one of us has seen the hand of God in our lives. And now it's up to us to decide. He calls us son. He calls us his friend. He calls us his heir. Will you love me? Will you trust me? Am I faithful? You have to decide and say. He led the children of Israel by force because the cross is there. Now after the cross, it is finished. Now it's for us to decide. My way or his way. Can we just say, Lord, thy will be done. Thy will be done. Thank you, Lord. What a privilege we have. We can talk to him. Thank you, Lord. What a joy to be called the Son of God. What a privilege to be his friend. We can talk to him. Hallelujah. Even if he doesn't talk, he says, come on, talk. I am listening. I am listening. We can pour out our sorrows. We can pour out our burdens. Let's come before him with a sincere heart. Thank you, Lord. Father, we praise you and thank you. Thank you, Lord. Just as you brought the children of Israel all the way from Egypt, planted them in a very fruitful land. And there's nothing more to be done. You did everything. That's what you have done in our lives. You brought us to Fort St. John from different parts of the world. It's you who has brought us here. We stand here and we look back and we say one simple thing, it's you who has been faithful and brought us to this point. We look unto you. Lead us. Guide us. Hold our hands. O Lord my God, how great thou art. Help us to trust you. Help us to know you more. And may our lives be a blessing for many. Thank you, Lord. Continue to speak to us as we go back to our places. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' most holy name we pray. Amen. Amen.